This lecture will deal with 1989 in Romania because it's such a specific, different case than the three cases we have examined with the help of the textbook and the materials on Canvas, namely Poland, Hungary and Czechoslovakia. And it is worth pondering why did those transitions, those revolutions happen while including mass movements included the roundtable talks. So why were those fairly peaceful, generally speaking, gradual? And what came before in those three cases that allowed for that to happen the way it happened? And why was Romania different? It will also shape, understanding that will also give an explanation to what will happen next. The transition from to democracy and to market capitalism, to market economy, not capitalism, which will happen differently in those three countries, later four, Poland, Hungary, Czechoslovakia, later Czech Republic and Slovakia. It will happen differently there and then differently in Romania. So it's worth pondering why and thinking of the context that preceded 1989. What we have learned about what happened in these countries leading up to 1989 and before, right? During communism. So keep these things in mind and try to let's try to understand these things. Well, in any case, it's worth dedicating a video lecture to Romania and 1989 in Romania because the events there are much misunderstood, and it's good for you to have a more thorough insight into that. So remember, right, that this state, Romania, right, was founded in 1918 in the shape that it had in 1989, right? And previously it was formed in 1859, right, with two provinces, Moldova and Wallachia, which had always been separate provinces, unified into something that they called Romania. It's 1859, 1878 they declared independence. 1918, these two provinces, right, of let's say here Moldova and Wallachia, right, which formed Romania, also incorporate Transylvania. But Transylvania was a different thing, right? And here you have to remember everything that we have discussed because, I mean, there's a point why we discussed those things, right? How these different provinces have always been a part of different cultural spheres, different political spheres, right? Transylvania, multi-ethnic, Western-oriented, a mix of you know, Orthodox, Catholic, Protestant, and so on, Hungarians, Romanians, Germans, Serbians, and whatever. These, Wallachia and Moldova, traditionally, you know, Byzantine, dominated by ethnic Romanians, Byzantine, I mean, Orthodox, belonging to the Orthodox Church, 90-some percent, right? And then either under Turkish influence or control, or you know, Turkish imposed rule, or then Russian imposed influences and rule because they were caught in between. So the dividing line that we have talked about so much until in this course, right, between the East and the West, between, you know, Orthodox versus Western Christianity, Catholic, Protestant, whatever it is, right, between that sphere of culture which we call Central Europe and you know, the more Eastern Byzantine influence, more hierarchic, more authoritarian versus, you know, the more bourgeois civilization of the Central Europe. Well, that dividing line goes right through Romania, just like it goes through, you know, Bosnia itself is a dividing line, right? And interestingly enough, it not just goes through Romania, but it actually coincides with the Carpathian Mountains, which kind of the range is kind of along the same lines. Right, this is why they formed those different provinces in history, right? So it's important to understand. So the capital in 1989, then, it's here in Bucharest. Do not ever confuse it with Budapest. And the city that we have to talk about is Timișoara, right here. Now, why do I put it here on the map? And I posted a map on Canvas with some other materials that you are expected to look at. Because this is right at the border, so Timișoara is about 60 miles, 70 miles from both Hungary at that point, and Yugoslavia. And remember that during communism, Hungary, after the 70s, was part of this, I had the so-called goulash communism, which was a more relaxed, more open, you know, there were those liberal economic reforms and so on. Yugoslavia had always their own way, they also had their own liberal sort of communism, right? More liberal than, you know, Romania, right? And the people of these this area, which is, you know, let's call it Transylvania, but it has many sub-regions, so it's important. This is actually Banat. It's called Banat, and this is well. You have some of these on the map. But the point is that these people here, you know, which historically have been part of, you know, this has been part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, part of that same culture. Not this part. This part had been under, you know, either its own, you know, Romania since after 1859, before, again, as I said, Byzantine, Turkish, or I mean, Ottoman, Russian influence, or, well, you know, control, whatever. So, multi-ethnic society, multi-religious society, and especially here, actually in this region, Banat, more so than in the rest of Transylvania, in Transylvania, and especially in Timișoara. So, in fact, Timișoara is often called, was often called the Little Vienna, right? Which, now that you know about the Austro-Hungarian Empire, you have a sense of what that could have meant, right? This place of meeting of different cultures, which we called multicultural, or rather, even better, intercultural, and not melting pot, right? Interculturality, well, that's this region, that is this region, right? Which the Austrian emperors have consciously cultivated as a multi-ethnic region. I mean, in this area of Banat, there had been, and there still are actually, about 10, 11, 12 different ethno-cultural groups. And not just, you know, again, in the sense of multicultural, intercultural society, not of melting pot, not just some remote ancestry. It means that people here speak Romanian, German, Serbian, Slovak, Czech, Croat, you know, name it. They even had a French village. They even had an Italian village in the time of the, you know, Austro-Hungarian Empire. So Bulgarian village and so on. So you have about 10, 11 ethnic groups here, which have kept their culture and have created the same type of interculturality that we talked about when we mentioned Vienna. I mean, even today, Timișoara is one of the few cities in the world that has three distinct state, meaning, you know, official theaters in each of the three major languages. So there's the Romanian National Theater, there's the Hungarian National Theater, national means state-sponsored, and there's the German National Theater, actually in the same building, basically, but I mean in adjacent buildings, and they have their own, you know, institutions. They have schools in all these languages, theater, the churches have services in all these languages, even more in the rest of the languages. You know, you go to the church, you will see, especially in the Catholic, Protestant, whatever, because most of the Orthodox are Romanian, but it's also Serbian, but in these you will see, you will have several services in different languages, okay? In different languages. Because this has been a multi-ethnic, again, sort of a, in miniature, sort of a, an essence of Central Europe, in the sense of a space of interculturality, right? Because that's, you know, the essence of Central Europe. So that's one thing. So, having belonged to this Western world, and when you read about Poland, to Central Europe, when you read about Poland, you remember the fact that the three different provinces that reformed Poland after World War I encounter so many problems because they have come from different administrative cultures, from having been under different administrative cultures for about 150 years. So the part that used to be of part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire was more advanced, had better prepared, you know, administration officers, rather compared to those who came from the formerly Russian-occupied territories and so on. So the same here. You see, this province, having been in the Austro-Hungarian Empire and having had its own distinct, you know, kind of history, tolerance and whatever, was, and even up to 1989, after 50 years of communism, remained different, meaning that the level of daily life, of economic development, even within Romania, dominated by the same dictator, was actually better in this side. That people traveled from the northeast here, or moved there, sort of an even internal migration to get better work, to get better food, to get better whatever. It's an interesting situation, right? It's sort of an imbalance of life quality within the same communist country, right? So besides that, also keep in mind that the closeness to these countries, which had a more sort of a liberal communism, you know, comparative. You know, remember, you know, Romania, you've seen the documentary, right, online. Romania was under a very harsh regime led by Ceausescu, right? In which he was a, you know, the dictator was in charge of a very extensive securitate, it was called repressive secret police, the wide network of, you know, spies of, you know, people, general population who, from the general population, snitches, right? That was the word I was looking for. Snitches, you know, there was no free travel abroad, by the way. In Romania, it was very hard to travel abroad. The borders were closed, basically, unlike in these countries, you know. All the means of communication were, there was a cult of personality, all the means of communication were suffused with this cult of personality of Ceausescu, which, of course, nobody believed, right? That's clear, right? There was this, you know, nobody, everybody had to play along. And especially in the urban centers and in Transylvania and in Banat, you know, this was just like Milan Kundera felt it as an affront for the Soviets or for the Russians to come and try to, you know, take over and deform Czech culture. The same was in many ways felt here. Remember, you know, the Austro-Hungarian Empire, a bourgeois empire in many ways, right? Well, that also applies here. The sort of a middle-class civilized values conflicted with this brutal sort of a primitive rule by Ceausescu, who was actually from the south, from one of the more backward regions. Okay. So there was this dual thing, and there were many tensions. But being here, right, and many people spoke all these, you know, languages, right, being in an intercultural space, well, they were not exposed only and solely to the official TV station, which actually broadcast 2 hours a day, right? And it was propaganda, right? They were nobody watching. Right? They were watching Yugoslav TV, which was very open and to the West, and broadcast all the movies that came out in the moment they came out in the West, and so on. And Hungarian TV, which again, and which was at that point liberalizing, remember 1989, it's already way ahead in, you know, changing the regime, right? We're talking December 1989, right? So all of these were very much attuned to what was going on. Much more so than some of us in Moldova, who either watched Romanian official TV or Soviet TV, right? Which even at that point might have been even a little bit more liberal than the official TV here, right? Or these people here who watch either Bulgarian, which was not no better, or Romanian. Still, the Bulgarian probably was better. So they were, you know, more open to what, I mean, informed with what was going on. Of course, throughout the country, people were listening to Radio Free Europe, which was kind of the major source of unbiased information, or Voice of America, actually. Right. So this is a cultural, civilizational context, and a specific context of, you know, being aware that we need to take into consideration. Then we also need to understand that the 80s were probably the most terrible decade in you know, Romanian communism. You know, I mean it's hard to, you know, to make such comparison given the Stalinism of the post World War II. So the first Stalinist period, which was probably actually even worse, right? But in terms of under Ceausescu, let's put it this way, since 65, after 65, the 80s were the worst part of the Ceausescu rule, let's put it that way. Which meant a lack of consumer goods, or tremendous lack of consumer goods, which were all rationed, because it was all sent to the export to pay the debt, as the documentary showed you. And again, just a worsening of the political control and continuation of this political control and of the invasion of this cult of personality, of this dictatorship in all aspects of life. You know, I mean, for example, you know, when you said a joke, if somebody told a joke, and there was a whole culture of jokes about communism, and it was a way of undermining the regime. It was one of the practices in Romania. There was a huge, you know, wave of continued production of jokes about Ceausescu, about whatever, which was sort of a grassroots, you know, opposition, sort of a dissidence, you know, making fun of it, undermining it with that. But that too, you had to be careful who you told those jokes, because, you know, the person sitting next to you on the table, the pub, could have been a snitch, and that happened many, many times, right? You know, your phone must could be bugged. You know, you had to be very careful who you say whatever. And I mentioned this in one of my comments in the discussion sections, that at this point in Romania, you know, the paranoia of the dictator went so far that, you know, people were not allowed to gather in groups larger than three in public. You know, restaurants had been taken down, were told to take down the curtains so that people couldn't gather in restaurants and organize, you know, opposition and so on. So under this dictatorship for, you know, which got worse in the 70s, early 70s, so for about 20 years now, you have a very harsh rule which never allowed the emergence of dissident movements as the ones we have seen in Hungary, Poland, and Czechoslovakia, right? And that is very important to keep in mind, because again, you have to ask yourself, why these differences? Why did the transition go gradually? What is the revolution? Why was there a velvet revolution in Czechoslovakia and a bloody revolution in Romania? So Romania did not have a 56, did not have a 53, did not have a 68, did not have a Solidarity, did not have a Václav Havel, did not have a Nagy Imre, did not have a Lech Walesa. Yeah. So there have been some dissidents, but much more minor, but much more just, you know, one here, one there, no organized dissident movement. Right? Of course, this was a result of not just these 25 years of dictatorship, but also previously Tsarism, you know, cutting off the elite, crushing down at the beginning, when communism was imposed in Romania, was actually, for a while, armed resistance, especially in the mountains, especially peasants, have resisted for 20, I think I mentioned it in one of my contributions, again on a different discussion, you know, armed peasants have, small groups of armed peasants have remained in the mountains of Romania until the 70s, since the late 40s, just a few of them. So there had been, you know, violent resistance to the communism, but generally speaking, that was very small, very tiny. You know, most of the people learned about it after 1989. No movement, no cohesive, no organized movement of dissidents. No big revolution in between 40 something and 89 that, as it did in you know, Hungary, as it did in Czechoslovakia, as it did in Poland, right, with 56, 68, and Solidarity, 1980, which had undermined the system, which had given some important shocks to the system, which had delegitimized the system there. Not that the system here was legitimate, but it's important to understand. There wasn't an accumulation of dissidents leading up to 89. So there was even a saying that, you know, there's this dish, which here we use the Italian word polenta for it, right? It's made of corn, and you know, it's one of the traditional food in Romania. And this polenta, and there is this saying that polenta doesn't explode, right? This was sort of a saying that, oh, Romanians will never rise up, meaning citizens of Romania, right? Many ethnicities we have, but it did. But it did, and it started here. So why did it start here? Well, I gave you some aspects. Well, let's look at what happened. So 15th of December in Timișoara, it was a Friday, and still under, you know, communism, the same, you know, there were daily, you know, cuts in electricity, there were cuts in cold water, hot water, all these, you know, the lack of consumer goods that we have mentioned. So on 5th December, everything seems like that, but there are a small group of parishioners of the Reformed, which is a Calvinist, right? Hungarian, ethnic Hungarian Reformed pastor, right? Who was one of the actual dissidents in Romania at the time, who protested the treatment of the Romanian that the ethnic Hungarians in Transylvania, about 2 million of them, suffered at the hands of the government in Bucharest, right? Of the Romanian government of Ceausescu, right? And he's been protesting this thing, you know, for the rights of the Hungarian ethnic minority, but also against the harsh regime. He's been, you know, he's been preaching basically from the pulpit against the regime, and it's a huge popularity, you know, not just among Protestants, you know, not just among Reform. You know, people came to hear him, right? It was an amazing thing. Well, the regime was trying to move him to some other part of the country, maybe even get rid of him. And his parishioners, in a gesture that was, you know, truly unique, remember, you couldn't gather in groups, basically, actually held a vigil, which is gathering outside with candles in a country where, you know, of course, religion was kind of bad. There were churches, but, you know, it wasn't a good thing. And, you know, but on the 15th, few people heard of this, but there was this group of his parishioners, mostly ethnic Hungarians. They were, however, joined through personal friendships, by some Romanian Baptist, evangelical, right? Neo-Protestant youth, who joined these ethnic Hungarians sort of in solidarity. And this really takes off on the 16th, and again, the whole thing is, you know, nobody really knows about these things. It's basically the one small square in Timișoara. And so on the 16th, which is a Saturday, and it's important to understand this and why I give you the dates and the days, because all of this happens in 6 days, Saturday. You know, I mean, it's, you know, from one word to the other, you know. This is the same what, you know, some of the materials posted said about, you know, the changes that happened in Czechoslovakia in about 10 days. But this also, you know, the whole thing from one type of a world to different type of world happens in 7 days. I mean, it really is something, with no preparation, no, you know, dissidence movement before, like in Czechoslovakia. So this is why it's so interesting. So on Saturday, which is 16th, that's when really things will start. This is why the Romanian Revolution is considered to be 16th to 22nd December 1989. And that's when the crowds grow, and regular people of all kinds of denominations or religions, obviously the majority are Orthodox, but they're Catholics, Protestants, or whatever they are, different ethnic groups, right, who live in Timișoara, start gathering and going there. And they stop the circulation of the public means of transportation, block the tram lines. People who are on the trams get down and join them. And this is when something that was a solidarity meeting of a vigil to stop, you know, this pastor from being removed. So kind of very narrow, you know, changes nature. Because they use this opportunity to suddenly shout. And this is very interesting that from the beginning they shouted a few things which were common. One, for better conditions of life, so they said, you know, we want bread, we want whatever. But at the same time, they also shouted from the beginning, freedom, we want freedom. So political demands, not just economic. So it's very important when you think about what is a revolution, how does it happen, and what are, you know, the conditions. And the same thing, this is when they start saying, down with Ceausescu, which in Romanian is a very short expression and very poignant. So all these at the same time, and that is a tremendous thing, you know. In a country, as you remember, where you were afraid, you had to be very careful what you said, to whom you said what, because, well, you might find yourself in some you know, dungeon being beaten by the secret police, right? That's an authoritarian regime for you. That's a totalitarian regime, any totalitarian regime, right? And suddenly you have a larger group of people who dare not only to say what was on everyone's mind, of course, yeah, well, at least the majority, at least clearly here in Timișoara, and shouting it out loud. I mean, that changes, you know, we talked about, and I mentioned this several times, I was pushing this idea of how do you build a space, physical and intellectual space, where you can that is not under the control of the regime. Well, think of this as an explosion of such a space in a larger, broader space that was controlled by the totalitarian regime, and suddenly you have an explosion of, well, for lack of better words, freedom. and of public solidarity. And remember the name of the labor union in Poland, Solidarity, right? Why was it called Solidarity, right? Because human, social, natural, organic solidarity was not allowed under communism, because everything was to be part of the party, in the party, through the party, for the party, and by the party. Okay? And solidarity undermined the whole thing. But this is similar, it's ad hoc, it is unorganized, it's organic. People out there, and suddenly there's a space of solidarity, and suddenly they you know, it comes out of everyone, and they shout solidarity, freedom. And then they move from this square, which was close to downtown, you know, the center of the place, center of the heart of the city. In European cities is downtown, right? This is where the most important buildings are, the symbol buildings, the squares, and this is where, you know, it is the center, this is the heart of the city, the symbol of the city. So they move downtown, and they start, and they also disperse and go to different places, go to the students' campus, to the local colleges, to raise the students. In the idea that they would come and so on, and to different neighborhoods to kind of spread the word and to shout this, you know, freedom. And this is also the moment when they do something that you have seen. If you paid attention in the Hungarian Revolution of 56, they cut out from the flag the communist symbols, because in most of these countries they have adopted the old flag, but they put on it some communist symbols of whatever shape or form. This is how they were all printed and made. Well, they cut it out. So you have actually on the cover of your Crampton book is an image from the Romanian Revolution, that image is from Bucharest, with a soldier waving this cut-out flag. Right? That is it, right? It's the free flag, right? So they wave that and they shout freedom and go around the city. I mean, it was exhilarating for whoever heard it. Because if you've lived through that situation, through that context, and you know, at that point, you have never heard something. You have never, you know, had the opportunity to witness such a thing. You know, and most of the people, you know, think about it, communism was already 50 years old in the country, so most of the people, in many ways, have never had a chance of, although they have hated the system, but they never had a chance to experience a different sort of a system than communism country. So that's happening, and obviously they are met with repression. Right? So you have, I don't know, police or military or secret police come out and start, you know, shooting. Right? And they send out some, you know, armored cars and start shooting. So this is when the shooting starts. So here's another important thing, that all of these protesters were unarmed, simple, mostly workers, mostly young people, and actually many children. You know, just like in the Hungarian Revolution, remember, or the Czechoslovak Revolution, and you guys have mentioned the idea of why so many youth, and that's a good question. And that's true also in Timișoara, right? And that happens on the 16th, which is 7. On the 17th, which is Sunday, people start hearing. People start, you know, who have not been touched by this, who have not heard this from the beginning, from the day before, they hear it from other people, and they hear that, well, something happened. And on Sunday, more people gather downtown. Again, they do the same thing, go around, and they're met with even more repression. The first night, there was some, but on the 17th was the big bloodshed in Timișoara. When the army was more ready, because the whole thing before, they caught them by surprise, for sure. But by the 17th, they were ready, and they sent out armored cars, shooting in unarmed population. And those sounds of guns, which nobody has ever heard in their lives, because, you know, sounds of, I mean, nobody owns guns, nobody, unless you were in the army, you have never seen a gun, and so on, sounds of guns from armored, which reverberate very powerfully, you know, across the city, which is about 300,000 people there, everybody kind of knows what is happening at that point. And this is when, you know, again, groups go to different neighborhoods, are joined, and there's a lot of bloodshed. Many people are arrested, many people are beaten, many people are injured, many people are killed, go to the hospital, and so on. And that's on the 17th. that's on Sunday. Meanwhile, nothing is happening anywhere else. And in fact, most of the country had no idea what was going on, because very little information from here got both around the country to what, right? They couldn't, you know, remember this is before emails. Maybe some people calling and whatever, they could do that, you know, friends. But not to the media. And foreign media wasn't really attuned to what was going on. The first news they would hear would be from tourists, and not that many, who went through Timisoara exactly at that time, and who travels there, you know, necessarily on the 16th of December. Why would you? I mean, that's just like a very happenstance. And who go across the borders to Hungary and start talking about, wait, this is what, something is going on there. And then from here, other parts of the country will hear it from foreign media. But not yet. It's just some rumors. But so on the 18th, which is Monday, right? The whole city is in a state of shock, because this such a thing never happened. You know, nobody has lived through violence. Nobody has lived through repression of this open form. You know, since the 50s or whatever. You know, and now these things happen. These things took place. So the people are in a state of shock, and but still, you know, sort of also encouraged by this, and it's sort of a door you open and things come up. And some other, and so in the afternoon, they again start gathering in the center, and there are some very tragic moments when, again, young people, children. The other downtown in Timișoara is, here is the opera, and here is the Orthodox Cathedral. And the downtown, I mean, one of the major squares is right here. It's a huge, huge square with buildings here and here. So the cathedral is here, and the opera is here, like, you know, the cultural and religious. And this is one of the main squares. And they gather in front of the cathedral, because again, the center is the center, the heart of the city. And this is before Christmas, and there's a tradition in Romania of singing carols and whatever. And they gather there, sing carols, and shout down with Ceaușescu and freedom. And this is when armed transporters pass by and shoot them, mow them down, basically, on the footsteps of the cathedral. I mean, this was... All of these things are then heard, that's the point. You know? And you can imagine the outrage. And all of these were sons and daughters and brothers and, you know, husbands and wives and whatever of other people from the same city, you know. So then the second day, the next day, 19th, which is Tuesday, something important happens, because as it was usual in the communist regimes, which you have read about, all major cities had a whole chain of, basically, here's the city, around them was a whole chain of huge industrial factories, huge industrial enterprises, because that was the whole forced industrialization that you have read about in commerce, right? And which means that there are, you know, factories with literally thousands of employees there, already there, okay? And what happened, the tremendous thing that happens on the 19th and then on the 20th, but on the 19th, they stop working, which was a huge thing, because, you know, strike was not something anyone has ever done, couldn't have, right? And yet they stop, because it's these workers, you know, whose relatives had been shot, and whose, you know, famously women among them who told them, well, our husbands had never came home. They were arrested, okay? So then the other workers get outraged and they just stop working. And the party sends, which was in charge with everything, right, including the economy, sends their delegates to the factories, and but they fail to reach an agreement. It actually goes pretty badly for them. You know, there's some little, you know, tussle and whatever, because they lost all authority. And here's, you see again the question of authority, of where does authority come from, when does it crumble, and so on. And that's on the 19th. But it's still nothing else is going on in the rest of the country. And somewhat fortunately, unfortunately, Ceaușescu himself, who, just like, you know, in Hitler's case, right, one of the problems with, you know, Nazi Germany on D-Day, when with the invasion of the Allies on Normandy, was that Hitler was asleep, right? And in the very centralized command, system of command, all important decisions need to come from the top. If the guy is asleep, nobody takes the decision. Nobody dares, nobody is allowed to. Kind of the same happened here in a way, because Ceaușescu at this point was, guess where, in Iran, which was a strategic partner of Romania at that point. So he was visiting Iran, you know, taking it easy, so to speak. And I think he comes back on Wednesday. But anyway, on Tuesday, right, that's when a major radical change happens. Because on Tuesday, the same, I mean, people from the all across the city, but especially these thousands of workers from the outskirts factories stop work and line up and move down to downtown. Thousands upon thousands upon thousands upon thousands. I mean, it was like the whole city was moving, on the move, right? Now, this is a key moment because you can shoot one, you can shoot ten, you can shoot one, you can't shoot a city. I mean, you can look at Syria today, but that's a little bit different because Syria, you know, is a country divided in many tribes. Actually, there is no Syrian identity we can talk about. So, no, it wasn't the case here. You know, there was a common entity, identity, right? It's harder to say I'm going to, you know, shoot my compatriots, you know. I mean, there's no such tribal differences. It wasn't an ethnic-based thing. Again, these were from all kinds of ethnicities and religions. Nobody asked what you were and whatever. But they moved down the city and got to the another place downtown, which was the headquarters of the county government, which was actually the party government. And they go there, and which was surrounded by armed police, but they go there, and by noon, on the 20th, which is Wednesday, by noon, the people of Timișoara own their city. And that is a tremendous thing, because remember, at this point, the whole country is still in the same sort of a darkness. And yet here you have a city that is free. You know, think again, this question of space of freedom. This city is free. The whole thing. They don't dare to shoot anymore. And there are some ministers, there are some members of the Bucharest government, of the national government, who were sent down to negotiate. Another interesting thing is that none of this, I mean, there were no leadership, there was no elite, there was no, it was all a popular, spontaneous movement. So when the question came to negotiation, and I posted on Canvas images from that county government, images from several of these dates, by the way, on Timișoara. But there's one exactly that noon on the 20th, on Wednesday, in front of the county government, when people are gathered there and they're calling from their delegates to come out to tell them what is going on. Delegates, this is what I'm getting. In the front of the county government, there are thousands and thousands of people who do they send to negotiate with the government representative? Because there's no elite, there's no Václav Havel, there's no Lech Walesa, there's nobody. So literally, there are people who are just taken from the crowd and say, no, you go. And they go. And these were like workers, completely unprepared politically or whatever, to negotiate. And since they had absolutely no authority except for the fact that they were ad hoc chosen by or pushed by the crowd, what they had to do is to periodically come out, and in the video you will see this, the video from the 20th of December in front of the county party county council, you will see them coming out on the balcony of the council and telling the crowd what is going on inside, because they needed the continued sort of a mandate and not to let the crowd get suspicious. It's a very strange thing. Very strange thing. So they come out and say, I just told them, what do you think? And the thousands of people, yes, no. Direct democracy in action. Messy. And it also helped that this is the middle of December. It would be, you know, winter, you know, with snow and everything, cold, just like winter here or whatever. That's a, you know, same. But this December and these days were unseasonably warm and pleasant. They're, you know, spring-like, which is never the case, never the case. So it was very favorable time for revolution, so to speak. And you would see people in t-shirts and so on. Which was, again, very strange. So, another thing happens on the 20th is that some of these thousands of people are in front of the party county council, but the other another big chunk of them go to this main square and occupy the opera. Because on the opera, on the balcony here, in fact, this is a balcony overlooking a huge square where you can fit tens of thousands of people. Beautiful sky. And this has been used before, for example, by Ceausescu when he came to, you know, in one of his official visits, and people were forced to crowd the square, and he would speak from the balcony of the opera. Well, guess what? The revolutionary break into the opera somehow managed to get microphones, speakers, everything, and the opera, and behind the opera, actually, this is also the national theater in Romania, behind it is the Hungarian National Theater, and the German. The opera becomes the headquarters of the revolution, and here becomes the headquarters of the people, of the because it's the heart of the city. And the sensation was that if we occupy this, we occupy the city. It's ours, in an interesting way. This is why in the next days, nobody will leave. You know, you will have people, thousands of people staying there overnight, and, you know, still it got cold in the winter, overnight, but they would not want to leave because it was a sense that this is how you could, because which institutions can you, there are no institutions to control. If I take over the, you know, they took over the party council, whatever, it doesn't, effective. How do you control, how do you take over a city? Right? And they took over the center, the heart of it. Right? So they also establish their heart here. And the third thing that happens on the December 20th, so by this time, Timișoara is a free city. But again, nothing is going on. Some small towns around Timișoara, because, you know, many people kind of commuted to work in Timișoara, so they knew. So you have uprisings in small towns around Timișoara, in this region, but not in other places. So there's a free city here, and many others around here that start to move. But the whole rest is the same. And that afternoon, Ceausescu gives an extraordinary speech, first of all, because there is no TV, there was no TV broadcast until, you know, late in the evening, between 8 and 10, there were 2 hours of broadcast. But in the middle of the day, there is this extraordinary broadcast, which, you know, the totalitarian regime tries to deny that anything is going wrong. When Tiananmen happens in China, nobody hears anything, right? When the recent explosions happened, the recent accidents where was it? Xinjiang or whatever, in China, you know, the local TV station, when a whole factory blew up and half of the, you know, a huge part of the city was razed down or whatever, its neighborhoods, the local TV station broadcast soap operas and cartoons. Okay, so that's how a totalitarian regime reacts to things. They don't exist, they deny. It's the control of information, the control of reality. That's what it is, right? Trying to manipulate reality, right? And reality comes back with the vengeance. So, in the middle of the day, Ceausescu gives a broadcast in which he is extraordinary because he admits that something is going on. And he says, I don't know, just like in 56, the party said that it was a counter-revolution, a fascist element, when the whole country knew that it was them on the street, in 56 in Hungary, the same thing happens here. But in this case, it referred just to Timișoara. And he says that hooligans, what's the word he used, in Timișoara, incited by foreign elements and whatever, have broken and whatever, and we need to maintain peace and order and whatever. So very similar to what you've heard in 56. And what was really powerful at that point was that for people in Timișoara, it was a surreal experience, because there it is, a city that is free. There it is, a city that is in a different time zone already. Seeing on TV a past that is still around and still sort of oppressingly hovering, but it's no longer them. It's no longer them. It's no longer what they're living. It's like this gray, dark past, you know, simultaneous with the present that is, you know, very bright and free. But it was also very scary, because, you know, nobody knew what would happen. I mean, to be straightforward, right? Sending in the army, tanks, airplanes to bomb the city, to raise it to the ground, why not? Right? Could have been possible. So it was sort of a mix of exhilaration, you know, because the city is, you know, ours, with anxiety, with fear, because, you know, next day could be the end in many ways. I'll continue this in a second.